Good morning, church family. How are you? It is a joy to be with you this morning. And Roderick, man, praise God. Amen. Praise God for that baptism. God continues to move in our midst. We've got a lot of youth lined up that you're going to see baptized over the next few weeks. And children and preteens, God continues to move in our midst. And we are thrilled. This is a party. This is a celebration of the fact that Jesus saves. And he continues to save. Praise God. Amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19. If you do not have a Bible, there's a Bible in the pew rack in front of you. Please take that out and make it your own as a gift from us to you. Okay? We're going to continue our walk through the book of Acts. Now, I'm going to give you a couple precursors. Acts chapter 19 can be one of those passages where some different theology is taught out of this, specifically like a second baptism from a charismatic background. I've already addressed some of those issues in an excursus, right? We did a whole aside. You can go, if you didn't catch that, you can go online where I deal with all of that specifically. I won't address that here this morning. Okay. Where we are in Acts 19, Paul is beginning his third missionary journey, okay? He came back from Corinth to Antioch. He stayed there a while, and now he has begun his third missionary journey. As he's going to Ephesus, Luke inserts two quick narratives for us, okay? And they highlight a theological point. Those two narratives are similar, but they have differences. At the end of chapter 18, we are introduced to a man named Apollo. Now, Apollo clearly is a Christian. Okay, he knows Jesus, but he has some holes in his theology. And Priscilla and Aquila take him aside. They invite him over to their home and address and fill in some of those theological gaps for him. And then Apollo goes on to do incredible things, okay? We learn a good bit about Apollo here at the end of chapter 18. And if I were giving, if we were walking through the book of 1 Corinthians, I'd probably stop and do a whole character study because we can learn a lot about Apollo. He leaves Ephesus and he goes to Corinth and becomes a great leader there. Okay, that said, for our purposes this morning, I really want us to be able to focus on Acts chapter 19, the second of those two narratives that come back to back here, okay? Because Paul is going to come across a group of disciples, okay? And in the so listen as I read Acts 19, the first seven verses. It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, that Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples. And he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said to him, "No, we have not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Well, then, into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they began speaking with tongues and prophesying. And there were in all about 12 men. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we worship you this morning. We have gathered together in your name to sing praises to your name, to see this young man baptized, to pray to you, and to open your word. And right now, Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit would teach us and convict us. Father, as we ask an incredible question this morning, that each of us would examine ourselves and see if we are in the faith, have evidence that the Spirit of God is inside of us. Father, that can be a very tender moment for each individual. And so right now, in Jesus' name, we pray that your Spirit would be tender and would lead and would clarify, would convict, would lift our eyes to the only name that can save, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Some 20 years after the Revolutionary War, after the Declaration of Independence and the founding of our nation, some travelers began to head west. And as they passed through some of the remote mountains and crossed the mountains in Virginia, they came across some of these remote settlements tucked away in the mountains. And they came across people who hadn't had contact with people for decades. And the travelers asked these mountaineers what they thought of the new republic and the policies of the Continental Congress. "We are loyal subjects of the King of England, and we have never heard of this new republic and the Continental Congress." Well, as you could imagine, they had a lot of catching up to do, okay? They had missed the entire Revolutionary War. And from that perspective, everything has changed. In our passage today, Paul comes across some who have missed the news of the death and resurrection of Jesus. Paul is shocked, and he begins to unfold for them and to announce that everything has changed. Paul, on his third missionary journey, he again goes and checks on the churches in the region that we know as Galatia. Those churches that he planted on his first missionary journey. He goes and he checks on them. And then if you'll recall, after the second missionary journey, he wanted to go down to Ephesus, but the Holy Spirit prevented him. Well, this time he is allowed to go. And he goes down to Ephesus, the crown jewel of Asia. And as he enters the city, Luke highlights for us a peculiar narrative, right? One that could have easily been skipped over. When you think through what stories got included in the Bible and which ones did not, you would come across this and Luke, you could have easily left this out, but he intentionally puts it here. And as we will see, there is a powerful theological point for why it's here. So Paul comes across a small group of disciples. Verse 7 tells us there are about 12 men. Now, it's possible there are women in the group, and these are only being identified as, well, there were 12 men. They are friendly, hospitable, and they have an immediate rapport with Paul. Paul is delighted to hear about their testimony, about how they were deeply impacted by John's ministry. You know, there hadn't been a prophet in 400 years when John the Baptist burst on the scene. And all will recognize, everyone recognized that he is a prophet sent by God, calling the nation of Israel to repentance, and he was baptizing out in the Jordan River. And many, they were coming from all over Israel. They were coming to him. And John's impact was known, and apparently these 12 journeyed to the Jordan. And they were baptized by John personally. Now, as Paul fellowshiped with his new friends, he could hear some holes in their theology. And the longer they talked, the more he realized something was missing. Have you ever baked a cake and forgotten an important ingredient? I don't know, like sugar? It looks like a cake on the outside. Doesn't really taste like cake, right? Let's not call that cake. Now, sure, these men were sincere. They were passionate about what they knew. They even spoke with an assertiveness, okay, that they had knowledge that few around them had. Have you ever talked theology with someone who's passionate and assertive? They're confident that they are enlightened. And then Paul does something bold. He questions their theology. He questions their theology. He didn't say, well, sincerity is really all that matters. Or, who am I to say to someone else that they are believing wrong? He questions their theology. Now, why? Before we move into the specifics of it, why did he question their theology? Because if he hadn't, they were going to hell. Because if he hadn't, they were going to hell. Beloved, they get saved in this passage. They receive the Holy Spirit of God and go from death to life. Yes, they were passionate and sincere and maybe even assertive, but they were still dead in their sins. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they said to him, no. We have not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit. And he said, well, into what then were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. And Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who is coming after him. That is, in Jesus. You see, although they had traveled great distance to be baptized by John, somehow they didn't comprehend the entire message. You see, John's ministry was simply a signpost, right? He was pointing towards the greater one who was coming, Jesus. And John baptized with water, but Jesus baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Now, John had said these things. That doesn't mean everyone always understands what is said. And this group is a perfect example of those who were sincere but without truth, of those who were repentant before God but not saved. Now, pay close attention, because I've just jumped from the narrative right up in your business. Repentance alone does not save you. And I say that as a warning, because for many, all they have is repentance. You see, repentance is knowing that you are a sinner before a holy God, feeling contrite, okay? Convicted in your conscience. And many of you live with an active, guilty conscience, sorrow and guilt, and you are constantly working on religious things to make you feel clean. But the Bible says two things are required for salvation: repent and believe. You see, repentance brings you to the hope of believing. Believe in what? that the death and resurrection of Jesus saves you. You see, to repent is to be sorry for what you've done, but to believe is to have life in what God has done. Martin Luther would spend hours upon hours in daily confession as a Catholic monk, right? Repentance. He wore out everyone around him because he would confess for hours and hours. And then he would leave and he would make it halfway back to his room and he would remember something else and he would go back and again begin in confession. He wore everyone out. You see, he had repentance and brokenness. He was contrite in spirit, but he didn't have life. John baptized with the baptism of repentance. But Jesus' baptism is a baptism of the Spirit of God. It's a baptism of life. I want you to think about baptism. Praise God, Roderick modeled for us that this morning. I want you to think about how baptism is a picture of a spiritual reality, okay? And that is, the Bible teaches, look, in Colossians chapter 2 or Romans chapter 6, that baptism, we are picturing the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ within ourselves, okay? That is, we, because of faith, we have identified with Jesus, and those promises have been applied to us. And yes, Jesus died and he was buried. And I love to joke when I baptize people, you're not going to stay under the water, are you? Well, you hope not, right? You hope we bring you back up. That's the picture of baptism. Baptism is a picture of life, of new life, of death and resurrection. Okay, so repentance is just, I feel sorry. If you believe in the baptism of Jesus, is that you now have life, eternal life, that the Spirit of God resides in you. Listen, I'm pulling this apart this morning because to only have repentance is to have nothing more than religion. Muslims, Jews, Buddhists, they all have some form of repentance. I had a Muslim classmate in college, and we became decent friends, and there was a particular time where we decided to go to McDonald's and just talk. Let's just talk about religion and what you believe and what I believe and go back and forth. And ultimately, my Muslim friend, he wanted to say, listen, we are the same. We are the same. He said, we worship on Fridays and you worship on Sundays. But we pray, we fast, we have holy religious days, okay? And we almost have an identical list of what is right and wrong. We are the same. That's what he said. And what he was saying is that we all agree on the problem of sin. But his solution was religion. And what I mean by that is repent and feel bad for your sins. And when you do that, you prove to God that you feel bad by doing religious stuff. And hopefully God will see your effort and your good works and then he will forgive you. Friend, that solution doesn't need Jesus. That solution is not the gospel. And that solution will send you to hell. And that's the reason that this passage is included right here. The Bible solution is not feel bad for your sin and then prove to God you're sorry by doing religious stuff, okay? Because that would ultimately exalt you, okay? That would say that you are trying hard enough. God's solution is his son, Jesus. That you were dead in your sins, but Jesus lived a perfect life. That you were dead in your sins, but Jesus died in your place. That you were dead in your sins, but Jesus rose from the dead. That you were dead in your sins, but Jesus now sits at the right hand of God the Father. That you were dead in your sins, but now you have faith in the finished work of God, in Jesus and in his promises. That you were dead in your sin, but the Spirit of God now indwells you, and that you have eternal life. And now out of that life, you walk different, and you worship him, and everything you do is an overflow of that changed life. Friend, I press this issue because all across America this morning, our churches are filled with repentant religious folks who do not believe the gospel and are not filled with the Holy Spirit and are lost. And they go to church out of guilt, trying to prove to God that they feel very sorry for their sins. Friend, if that is you this morning, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. John Wesley's early life suggested that he would certainly become a man of God. You guys know John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist and one of the most influential people really in the last 200-300 years. He was the son of a clergyman, Samuel Wesley. And his mother had a stunning reputation for godly living. And after a privileged upbringing, John attended Charterhouse in Oxford, and he became a double professor of Greek and logic at Lincoln College. Now, he also served as his father's assistant and was ordained by the church. It's starting to become a heck of a resume. While at Oxford, he was a member of the Holy Club, a group that was so nicknamed by other students because they seriously attempted to cultivate their spiritual lives. Finally, he also accepted an invitation to become a missionary, okay, over to the United States to the American Indians. Well, he would take that call. He would utterly fail. And as he returned to England, he wrote, "I went to America to convert the Indians, but oh, who will convert me?" Not all was lost, however, because in his early travels to America, he came across Moravians who had a living faith that so impressed him. One particular conversation he had with a Moravian pastor who pressed him and asked him this question: "Does the Spirit of God witness within your spirit that you are a child of God?" Wesley didn't know what to say. "Do you know Jesus Christ?" the pastor pressed. "I know that he is Savior of the world." "True," the pastor responded. "But do you know that he saved you?" Wesley sat stunned in silence. Upon his return to London, he sought out a Moravian leader and confessed that he needed saving faith. Think about this, because here is the son of a minister. He is an ordained pastor and a Greek professor. Okay, he's a missionary for crying out loud. And he is confessing, "I need saving faith." So on the evening of May 24th, 1738, Wesley wrote in his journal. He said, "This evening I went unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street where someone was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. All right, so back in those times, for entertainment, you would go to a public book reading. All right, that's a little different time. Probably don't do too many of those, right? Public book readings. And it's Luther's preface to the Epistle of Romans. About a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, Wesley writes, "I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given to me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death." You see, after all of those check marks of being the son of a minister, spending his whole life in church and part of a club called the Holy Ones, he had to encounter Jesus Christ and have personal faith. Repent and believe. The reason that Paul, coming across this group of disciples, immediately asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" is because Paul knows that to be saved, you must have the Holy Spirit. And if you do not have the Holy Spirit, you are not saved. Romans 8:9 says this plainly. So let me ask you, friend, if you call yourself a Christian, if you believe this morning that you are a Christian, do you have evidence of the Holy Spirit in your life? Now that's a scary, bold question, isn't it? You say, do I have evidence of the Holy Spirit like in the book of Acts where fire came down in tongues and landed upon them and they spoke in other languages? No, that hasn't occurred, Pastor. Now, I've covered this as we've walked through the book of Acts, but a few reminders here would be helpful. Number one, a lot of what you see happening in the book of Acts is a transition from the presence of God in the temple there in Jerusalem, transferring to the people of God. There's a transference of the covenants. And so some of the activity is a one-time only magnificent event, okay? And secondly, there are a lot of miracles surrounding the apostles because God was giving evidence that the apostles are prophets, that you should listen to them. Okay, remember, just a quick example of that is in Acts chapter 9, Peter performs a miracle that parallels and is almost identical to a miracle that Jesus had performed in Mark chapter 5. They use the same words. There's all these parallels. You see, God was giving witness. Now, Pastor, are you saying miracles do not occur? That is not what I'm saying. But I am saying that when we read Acts, it's not necessarily prescriptive for us, meaning it's going to look this way for us. A lot of times when you read the book of Acts, it's descriptive about what happened with the apostles. Okay, so that said, let's focus back on this question. Do you have evidence of the Holy Spirit in your life? Now, I need to set up guardrails, okay? Because almost everything in Christian theology, there's a balance so that I can help. I want to press this, but I want to set up guardrails. What I do not mean about evidence in your life, I want to put up a guardrail against ecstatic experience. Dreams, speaking in tongues, prophecy, miracles. The guardrail here is that those things are irregular in the Bible. and therefore they cannot be a test for whether you are in the faith. Okay? Very few have those gifts. Very few see those type of gifts. Additionally, the Bible teaches that these types of things need to be tested because there is much counterfeit that can be stirred up with emotionalism. And if our emotions are the basis for anything, then we are all in trouble because I have good days and I have bad days, days where I don't feel like a Christian at all, okay? So when I'm asking you this question, do you have evidence of the Spirit of God in your life? I do not mean, do you always feel like a Christian or have you had a lot of ecstatic experiences, okay? On the other side, in our cerebral Western minds, we are quick to eliminate the Spirit and deal only in facts. Well, have you said a sinner's prayer? Have you walked an aisle? Have you been baptized? Like Wesley, do you believe that Jesus is Savior of the world? But nothing is personal. You do realize that to claim to be a Christian is to claim that the Holy Spirit of God indwells you. And that's going to show up at some point in your life. That has to work itself out. So what does the Bible indicate? One, I would tell you that the Holy Spirit is personal. Okay? The Spirit gives witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. That is a peace, a joy, a love for God, and a growing love for the things of God. I don't mean right now, always, because we can have our emotions can confuse us, but generally, as you look at your life, you should see evidence of this because the Spirit of God is personal. And let me just tell you, when I have been most confused in my life, because we have those moments where we're really confused with what's going on, and it's usually clouded by a lot of sin, okay? When I have been most confused, I have been able to get alone, get quiet with the Lord, remove distractions, and come to a realization, I love Jesus. He has given me a heart that beats for him. Okay? He's personal. Number two, the Spirit brings conviction of sin. If you can live like the world, ignore God, and never come under conviction of sin, all I have to say is warning, warning, you may not be a child of God. Because God is a good father, and every good father disciplines his sons and daughters. In fact, those have been breakthrough moments with my kids. Years ago, Ian couldn't sleep because he had covered up a sin, but he was restless over it. And so he comes to mommy and daddy late into the night and needs to talk to us and tell on himself because he was under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. David said, when I hid my sin, I wasted away on the inside. It's like I was sick with fever, Psalm 32. And honestly, a Christian should feel like I never get away with anything like everyone else. Everyone else can do a bunch of stuff, but I'm always getting caught. That's what it feels like to be a Christian. Thirdly, that is, the Holy Spirit will produce the fruit of the Spirit over time. Okay? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. And you should be able to notice, and others should be able to notice over time. Okay? Not perfection, but in increasing measure. The Bible clearly states that God's aim is to transform you into the image of his son. Now, for some of us, that's going to take much longer than others. But if God is in you, he is making progress over time. It's not comparison to other people. It's against your old self. Friend, it is good to examine yourself to see if you are in the faith. These are eternal matters. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? If your answer today is yes, then would you pause and marvel at God's goodness in your life? That you have eternal life. He is holding on to you. That is finished. If your answer this morning is maybe, Pastor, you've really confused me. You've pressed this issue. Find somebody who's spiritually mature. Someone you trust and have a conversation with them. These are far too important matters for you just to remain confused, okay? Talk to someone. You can know, you can have assurance and confidence that you are in the faith. Any pastor on our staff would love to follow up, sit down with you, take you to coffee, work through these things. It's too important to leave it to chance. But if your answer to that question this morning, have you received the Holy Spirit when you believed, is no. Today is the day of salvation. Our God is near. He gave his son for you. He is a God who draws near to you. And he has promises for you. Not that you have to clean yourself up. You can't clean yourself up enough for him. But he will do it all for you. That's his offer. That's his promise. Repent and believe in the goodness of Jesus Christ, in his promises, and he will gift you his Holy Spirit who indwells you permanently, who will take out your heart of stone and insert a heart of flesh that beats for him. That is his promise, okay? And I did that more than 25 years ago. And let me continue to give witness and testimony that he has saved me, that he has changed me, and that he is the greatest decision ever. And today is the day of salvation. Would you pray with me? If you need to cry out for Jesus and for salvation right now, with your head bowed and your eyes closed, would you confess, I repent and I believe, Jesus. I believe in you. I need you to save me. Yes, I have sinned. And I fall short of your holiness, God. You are perfect. But I have heard good news that you have sent your son, and that he died in my place, and that he resurrected to give me life. And I ask you right now, in Jesus' name, to forgive me and to cause me to be born again. And with your help, King Jesus, I will follow you the rest of my life. But it is only if you empower me and you change me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As the praise team comes and leads us in a final song, church family, you are invited to respond. Right? I gave you three options there, right? For most of us, honestly, in this room, it is time to stand up and shout hallelujah. The Spirit of God is inside of me. He has saved me, and to rejoice and to revel in that. If you need to pray with someone, if you need to lay your burdens and your doubts down or have someone walk with you, come on. Don't be too proud. We are a family. We are all sinners saved by grace. You saw how they shouted for that baptism, right? You saw how they shouted. They will do the same for you. Do not hesitate. If you need to accept Jesus as your Savior, come. Be obedient right now. Today is the day of salvation.